Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka, I warmly welcome all of you who have come here today to listen to the Wimalasurendra Memorial Oration. Wimalasurendra Memorial Oration is an important event in the calendar of the ISL, and I thank all of you for having gathered today. In order to start the proceedings, I would like to invite the following dignitaries to light the oil lamp. Our President of the Institute of Engineers, Sri Lanka, Engineer Wimalasena Gamage, President-elect Engineer Jayavilal Meegoda. We have two senior past presidents, Engineer Professor KKYW Perera and Engineer Chula De Silva. I would also like to invite our guest speaker today, Engineer TM Sarath K Tilakaratna. We would also like to have a member of the family of late Engineer DJ Wimalasurendra also to come and light the oil lamp. Then also our chairman of the Electrical and Electronic Sectional Committee, which is organizing this event. The chairman is Engineer Kosal Kambaradhaniya. I would like to invite him also to come up and light the oil lamp. Thank you for lighting up the oil lamp. May I now call upon Engineer Wimalasena Gamage to garland the photograph of Engineer DJ Wimalasurendra. I would now like to invite Engineer Wimalasena Gamage, our guest speaker, Engineer TM Sarath K Tilakaratna, Engineer Kosal Kambaradhaniya, Chairman of the Electrical and Electronics Sectional Committee of the ISL, to take their seats at the stage over here. I would now invite Engineer Wimalasena Gamage, President of the Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka, to deliver the welcome address.
Good evening, past presidents, Engineer Sarath Kumar Tilakaratna, our guest speaker today, vice presidents, chairman of Electrical and Electronic Section Committee, council members, family members of late engineer DJ Wimalasurendra, distinguished invitees, fellow engineers, ladies and gentlemen. I consider it is my privilege to welcome all of you to the memorial lecture of late engineer DJ Wimalasurendra. Today, we all are gathered here as a members of the Lone Society to pay tribute to late engineer DJ Wimalasurendra, father of the hydro power in Sri Lanka. It is our responsibility to educate the present generation, especially the engineering fraternity, on how our forefathers dedicated their service to develop our country in a sustainable manner despite economic and social constraints. This lecture, instituted in 1989, is in memory of late engineer D.J. Vijayasundaran. September 70th is his date of birth. This year, 142 birth anniversary, and this is the 27th memorial lecture being held. Engineer Deyapura Jayasena Wimalasurendra, born in 1874 in Goa, was educated at Ananda College, Colombo, excelling in science and mathematics. He joined the Technical College in Colombo in 1993 while serving as apprentice at the government factory, and was his first graduate in civil engineering. He completed his engineering studies in 1898 by sitting for an examination conducted in India by the Institution of Civil Engineers, UK. Engineer Wimalasurendra worked for some time as an assistant civil engineer at then Public Works Department, serving at stations like Diyatalawa, Kol and Novo. The Damodara railway loop was designed and constructed by him in 1901. While being stationed at Diyatalawa, it was during his service at the PWD that he became interested in hydropower projects. In 1912, he proceeded to UK to specialize in electrical engineering and gain Faraday House diploma in 7 months, and also gaining associate membership of Institution of Engineers, Electrical Engineers in Britain. Having had his initial proposal on hydropower ignored by the then Engineering Association of Ceylon, he constructed Ceylon's first small hydropower station in Blackpool between Norelia and Nanwe to supply electricity to Norelia town. In 1918, he published his historic paper titled Economics of Power Utilization in Ceylon, before then Engineering Association of Ceylon, arguing the case for the development of hydro potential of the country. He also strongly promoted the electrification of railway as well as the concept of developing the national grid. His concept now realizing a near future as a railway electrification under ADB grant funds, mainly IESL responsible to implement that. He was a chartered engineer, both the Institution of Civil Engineers UK and the Institution of Electrical Engineers UK, a somewhat rare achievement at that time. He did in-depth study of the Laxapana hydroelectricity project, which the government accepted in principle for implementation in 1924. However, it took another 15 years of the government to decide on its actual implementation. He was, however, left out of the project and left the country on leave to England and returned only in the request of the colonial secretary. In 1926, he was appointed as chief engineer PWD soon after he began the separation of the electrical section. With the setting up of the Department of Government Electrical Undertakings, Engineer Wimalasurendra was appointed to the position of chief engineer. However, he retired as a frustrated man at the age of 55 in 1929 with his pet project in abeyance. In view of promoting his vision and determination to develop the hydropower potential of the country, Engineer Wimalasurendra decided to enter National State Council and was elected from Ratnapura in 1931 as the member of the Ratnapura seat for more than half years, and served in the Executive Committee of Works and Communication. He lobbied for the resumption of works on hydropower that was uncompleted. As a result, the Laxapana hydropower scheme, which has started in 1924 and had been stopped, was resumed in 1938 and completed after the war in 1950. In 1933, he proposed the formation of Central Electrical Authority. In 1935, the National State Council passed the Electrical Board Establishment Ordinance No. 38, 1935. However, the board was dissolved in 1937, and the Department of Government Electrical Undertaking was re-established. During the period from 1931 to 36, as a member of the State Council, he continued to advocate strongly the road of industrialization of the country using the cheap source of power, hydroelectricity. Engineer Wimalasurendra was about almost 75 years ago, when in 1950 the Laxapana project was finally completed. Engineer Wimalasurendra, the father of hydroelectricity in Sri Lanka, passed away in August 10, 1953. Norton Powerhouse was named after his name, after him, 1974. Professor C. Sundaralingam, his colleague in the State Council, paid the best tribute to him when he said, "Wimalasurendra is not dead, he is living light. Laxapana, a lack of light." Today, Engineer Sarath Kumar Tilakaratna is with us to deliver the Wimalasurendra Memorial Lecture. He is actually Deputy General Manager, Mahaweli Hydro Power System Complex in CEB. He is graduated from the University of Peradeniya, and he is the Chief Engineer Kotmale, Victoria Power Station, and subsequently appointed as a Deputy General Manager of the Mahaweli Engineering Complex. Now I may invite Engineer Sarath Kumar Tilakaratna to deliver the Engineer lecture. I think you are so fortunate. You are the engineer from the industry, still connected with hyperpower, and I think we may be able to share with your thoughts in your topics, future role of hydropower and operation and maintenance of the challenges. Engineer Tilakaratna.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, President, Institution of Engineers, Engineer Wimalasena Gamage, President-elect, Engineer Javilal Megoda, past presidents, Professor KKYW Silva, Engineer Chulada Silva, relatives of late Engineer DJ Wimalasurendra, members of council, members of ISL, ladies and gentlemen. This is an honor for me to present DJ Wimalasurendra Memorial Oration. I think this is As Wimalasena Gamage said, Mr. Engineer Wimalasena Gamage said, it is fortunate for me to deliver this type of presentation. My topic is today is future role of hydropower and operation and maintenance, O&M challenge. Before going to topic, let me share some thoughts with you about great visionary who lit up our motherland and became legend in his lifetime. Late Engineer DJ Wimalasurendra was a visionary leader who saw the required future of the country far ahead of others. His vision was a holistic because his intention was to use low-cost hydroelectric power to uplift lives of people by developing economy of this country. But late Engineer Wimalasurendra worked lifelong struggle to make his dream a realization. hydropower in Sri Lanka. Because of that, he was honored as father of electricity schemes in Sri Lanka. Engineer Wimalasurendra graduated in civil engineering from Ceylon Technical College. He received associate membership of Institution of Civil Engineers. In 1912, he specialized in electrical engineering and received membership of Institution of Electrical Engineers, Britain. He joined the Public Works Department, PWD, at overseer, then who was promoted as Junior Assistant Engineer by 1900. During his work in upcountry, he saw that potential energy available in Muskilewer Kelgumoyer. He estimated that 114.5 megawatts can be generated from that streams, and he said that 100,000 lamps can be lit from this that power. That's called, that's in Sinhala, Laxapana. Then it name it as call it as Laxapana. Actually, the introduction of the engineer Wimalasurendra was given by our president, engineer Wimalasiri Gamage. Because of that, I skip those slides to my main topic. Outline of my topic is today. Historical background of power generation in the country, present status of power generation, hydropower complexes in the country, future roles, challenges in operation and maintenance, summary and conclusion. In 1902, at that time, biggest power plant capacity of 3 megawatt was set up at Peta to give power to Colombo City. That was steam power plant. In 1905, diesel power plants was set up in Kandy to provide electricity to Kandy City. Engineer Wimalasurendra, he put his idea to colonial government to build up hydropower station at Kelgumoyer and Muskilewer tributaries, but that was accepted by that government, English government at that time. Anyway, he tried to start it somewhere around 1912, but no support was received from the high management officials. He has to abandon. Later on, he has published a paper in Institution of Engineers in 1918, and he put his idea to promote hydropower in the country. After all, in 1923, British government, the colonial government, they give the colonial government give the approval to start the hydropower project, but it was abandoned in 1924 because of the high expenditure incurred to that project. In 1913, he constructed a small hydropower power plant in Blackpool in between Nanuaya and Norelia to give electricity supply to Norelia town. Then 1938, after his long struggle, he could able to start the project in 1938. That project was completed in 1950. That is the Laxapana stage 1 hydropower project. This is after completion of the project. This is one of the picture in somewhere in 1950. In 1950, late engineer Wimalasurendra visited to the plant, Laxapana site, and he recalled his memories and said that although it was not my fortune to execute the scheme I have originated, I am happy that I lived to see it brought to fruition by my countrymen, and then I should have in the evening of my life able to see in reality the dawn which I saw in the mind's eye over half a century ago. Now if I leave this world, I live fulfilled. Present status of the power generation in Sri Lanka. Total capacity is 3846.9 megawatts. Out of that, 2884 megawatts belongs to Ceylon Electricity Board, from which 1377 megawatts from hydro source. Private power producers, there have been 963 megawatts. Out of that, mini hydros 306.7 mini hydros. Then install capacity by source. Majority share comes from hydropower. Second major share comes from thermal oil, that is 29%. Thermal coal share is 23%. Mini hydro 8%, and other non-conventional renewable energy share is 4%. Let's see last 25 energy utilization of this country. This graph clearly indicates that increase of the thermal power generation in the country. Up to 1995, major share of electricity, electrical energy had taken from hydropower. From 1995 upwards, thermal energy share significantly increased. It's a blue color hydro share. You can see up and downs, up and downs because of the weather condition of the country. In average, it has calculated that normal average the expected energy from hydro is somewhere around 4,500 gigawatt hours. Let's see the generation mix. Up in year 2014 and year 2015, major share has come from hydro. 2014, that share was 37%. In 2015, 46%. 2015 was a very bad weather. This is a daily load. This is a daily load curve. You can see daily load in this load curve. You can clearly you can see base load is now comes from coal power generation, and hydro power mainly can be used for to cover peak power needs. We are having three hydro complexes, namely Laxapana, Mahaweli and Samanala. Laxapana complex is in Kalani River. It is having two main tributaries called Kehelgomoya and Maskelioya. There are five power plants and another power plant, Broadlands, it is under construction. Two major reservoirs are located in the upstream of Kehelgomoya and Maskelioya. Mahaweli complex, it is the biggest hydro complex in Sri Lanka. There are eight power stations, seven major power station, one mini hydro. It is having total capacity of 815.2 megawatts, and it is having three large reservoirs. The first large reservoir is Siranai Samudre, second one is the Randanigala, third largest is the Victoria. Then other complex is Samanala complex. Samanala complex is mixed with non-conventional renewable energy too. It has two major power plants. One is Samanala Vava, other one is Kukuliganga. Samanala Vava and then the mini hydro Udavalava, they are located in Valave Ganga. And Kukuliganga, the capacity of 70 megawatts, is located in Kuda Ganga, tributary of Kaluganga. Iginiagala power station, that is located in Galloya, downstream of the Senanayaka Samudre. That is the largest reservoir in the country. This is a combined storage of the combined storage of water in the large reservoirs. As in the form of energy, major energy storage can be stored in Mahaweli reservoirs. And second Second largest storage is at Laxapana and third one is at Samanala level. Total at full supply level, total energy storage is somewhere around 1250. Normally at present day, our energy requirement of the day is somewhere around 40 gigawatt hours. In this reservoirs, at full supply level, we can store energy of about 1200. Then imagine that energy is equal to the 1 month's operation, the energy need of the country. And other thing, you can see this is a 2015 combined storage circle graph. In this side, you can see all these reservoirs at near to spill levels in January, somewhere in January and end of the year and the beginning of the year. Yeah. Normally, we are experiencing water spills during this time. Importance of hydropower. From earlier graph I showed you that in hydropower we can store about 1200 gigawatt hours. Then hydropower is very useful energy storage, very interesting and we can store about 1200 gigawatt hours in these reservoirs. It helps to maintain the energy security of the country. Hydropower plants very flexible, very easy to operate. Within about 2-3 minutes we can start machines. I show you the one graph. It shows that hydropower is mainly used for peak power management. Actually, this peak power management, if you use hydropower, that is very cheap, and we can control our production cost by using hydropower for peak power balancing. On the other hand, If we increase the hydropower energy share, then it is greatly affect to our energy production cost. If it is increased, we can reduce unit operating cost. And also hydropower means clean energy. Future role. Optimize energy. Normally we are experiencing two monsoonal rains. Nowadays, because of this global climatic change, we are receiving the thunderstorms at different times. But anyway, we are experiencing monsoonal rains. In this monsoonal rains, we are getting it very hugely. And it is tending to spill water at that time. If we catch up this spill water in some means, that means we can generate more energy. Because at present, I think the government policy decision, they are going to put up small non-conventional renewable energy units, solar, then wind, like that. Because of those plants, normally they are very climate dependent and weather dependent, and because of those plants, we can expect a lot of the system fluctuation. In that fluctuation, I think the hydropower plants can be used to the respond to this fluctuation, because the optimized reserve operation. As I said before, because during the monsoonal seasons, we are getting lot of inflows, because we have to optimize reservoir levels to collect the inflows without wasting as a spill. Drinking water supply. Normally drought season, I can remember when my childhood, we happened many occasions to find water, because I was living in Kandy area, that's called Gampala too. We experienced the water shortages in some years, but after this construction of these two larger reservoirs, now we are not experiencing it, because we can regulate drinking water supply along the river. And what I believe, this water table is also now somewhat in higher levels. Improved flood controlling. We know that before construction of hydro reservoirs, many floods occurred due to flash flows. Because of these large reservoirs, now we are capable of controlling or regulating. We can regulate the water, the sudden flash flows. We can control to some extent, and we can reduce any impacts to the society. From hydro, what is demanding? Hydro plants usually is asked to run on part load to regulate frequency and load demand. Normally thermal plants, it is not possible to run on part load at the moment, but there may be some machines. Buy machines to cater to that requirement, then there may be machines to cater to this part load running. But at the moment, most of the time part load the supply is coming from hydropower plants. Because of the peak load supply from the hydro plants start to increase in the hydro plant start stops. If this start stops the increased start stops leads to failures in equipment and components. More start stop means lot of wear and tear and mechanical failures. High availability and reliability. We know that high service level is now is respected by our society. Because of this, to cater to this high service level, stringent regulating standards will come into effect. Occupational health and safety, that is one of the challenges. Those who works in our organization, and not only those who are working in our organization, there are some people, those students mainly, public, they are visiting station, power stations. We have to take care of their safety and health. Environmental needs. Our day-to-day operation, we have some waste and we use some gases and some materials. They are sometimes hazardous to the environment. But leftovers or through the waste, we should carefully dispose. Challenges operation and maintenance. Operation optimization. Hydro plants, if we run at full loads, or the plants are designed to get high efficiency. No, present plants, they are designed to give the high efficiency at higher loads. But we have to run these plants at part loads. The loss of this part load operation, loss of energy due to part load operation, it is not noticed to everybody. But water spilled from the reservoir, everyone noticed and everyone worried about spilled water. Therefore, operation optimization is essential to harness extra energy that we can gain from the hydro plants. Increased plant start stops is a challenge for us as main operation and maintenance staff. We know that lot of failures can expect because of frequent start stops. To avoid post breakdowns, post outages, we have to do maintenance. The need more planned maintenance to monitor and to avoid breakdowns. Other challenge is build up our competent workforce. Normally, for the higher levels, we can employ the qualified people. But for the bottom line, it is not possible. We are getting people with no skill or technical training. To overcome challenges, we have to do effective and efficient planning. Effective and efficient asset operation and maintenance. For that, we have to use strategic maintenance management tools like condition-based maintenance, reliability centered maintenance, like that. We have to optimize all the resources we use for the power generation, especially inventory. Actually, we tied up lot of the lot of asset in inventory. we have to carefully evaluate and the manage the inventory to at optimum levels. HR, as I said before, because for the bottom line people, we are getting with the not very experienced, very trained people, but we have to we need lot of time to train them. Very importantly, we should collect all these operation, maintenance and performance data accurately and timely. And the data we are collecting, we should collect that data at the location. We should enter that any data only once. If we enter in at different places, those are not reliable, and there are some inaccurate data. Because of that, we should collect data then and there. Some of the data can be online and other data can be offline. This data we should archive. We have to preserve this data for the future use of the organization. After analyzing all this data, we have to re-engineer our processes for the improve our day-to-day activities. Some of the hydropower structures are owned by different organizations. We have to work with them mutual understanding for the benefit of either party. Especially in Mahali complex, dams are owned by Mahali authority and power plants owned by CEP. Then we have to work together and we have to share their information and data. We need, both parties need those data for calculating or forecasting their information. Not only the data we sharing between the Mahali and CB, but sometimes we need some data from weather department, the meteorological department, to forecast our the inflows and weather condition to judge our future plans for this the plant operation. Build up competent workforce. We can do train our people on the job. We do major repair works together with the original equipment manufacturers. We put our people to work with them. We have done lot of works, the lot of repair works with them. It is very good opportunity for them to train on the job. And for this theoretical, to obtain theoretical knowledge, we give classroom training, internal or outside training. We need, it is essentially needed workforce. The essentially it is needed to improve work habits and culture in the organization to make our loyal workforce. If we have loyal workforce, I think we can do our jobs very well and we can perform very well. Continuous improvement and development. Continuous improvement and development is essential feature and culture of an organization. In this more dynamic world, things change very fast. If we fail to adapt continuous improvement and development, it is difficult to sustain the business. To achieve this, what are we needed? We have to adapt new technology to assess plant health. Then to capture operation data and information, we should use SCADA DAC systems. In maintenance management, that is important, the function we have to do to maintain plants in good condition. Computerized maintenance management systems. To resource optimization, we need enterprise resource planning softwares to make correct decisions. But most importantly, we should operate those things and maintain those things, maintain all these systems to monitor and evaluate performance of organization. It should not be alien, but should be owners and masters of them. Then we can assure sustainability. I would like to share one of our projects. We now in Mahali complex, we are running computerized maintenance management system from year 2013. Actually, we have started in one station as a pilot project in year 2012. And after 1 year, we were able to put into live operation that system. And at the moment, in 2015, July, in 2015, February, we started to implement the CMMS system in other stations. Within about 6 months, we managed to put all the system into operation within about 6 months. Now all the stations are equipped with computerized maintenance management system. We can plan centrally now. We can see all the information data centrally, and we can optimize our resources in better than before. In this module, this is some few modules of ERP system, and we have procured 4 modules: service and maintenance, procurement, inventory, document management, and the business analytical tool. Service and maintenance module, we can maintain our asset database, both main equipment, then tools and machinery. Then other thing is work order management, preventative, the routine, the condition based, and breakdown meter. Once you enter a breakdown to the system, we automatically generated mail is coming to all the stakeholders. The other important thing is with this system we use to record plant performance, measurement, testing data. All things are in now one database. We can use this data for the reviewing and the making decisions to make decisions on asset modifications. Procurement is another important module. We can use that procurement module for the material from material request to warehouse. Inventory management. Now our inventory, our Mahali complex inventory is maintained in international standards. If you go to a warehouse, you can see how we organize all these spare parts, and it is transparent. No need to go to the warehouse. You can see from your personal computer. Other important module is document management. All the document test records or any drawings we can attach to the assets in our system. Business analytic tool, which is very important tool, because using that tool we can generate the analytical reports the using the data stored in the system. These are some reports. This is this is 13 months plant failures. There are about 49 there are 8 power plants. There are 40 odd plant trippings we registered in the system. This is all the poles. There are about 700 odd poles, all the power stations in the complex for the last 13 months. Summary: with increase in demand in service level, stringent standards will come into effect. Therefore, it is needed to align all the processes to meet that standards. Education and training has important role for developing competence of employees and to build up favorable corporate mindset. To meet the rising energy demand, adding various other energy sources is inevitable. Therefore, the cost of production increases, and optimizing of all resources is essential requirement. To achieve these demands, state of new art tools are needed for monitoring, assessment, evaluation, to measure performance, and for setting up goals for required results in the future. Conclusion: late engineer Wimalasurendra was an engineer by excellence, committed to uplift the society in which he lived. It was his heartfelt desire and sensibility towards people of this country. Moreover, late engineer DJ Wimalasurendra was one of the greatest sons of our soil. We can pay him our gratitude by dedicated serving for the country for economic prosperity. We need great extraordinary people among many good ordinary professionals to make a change, as late engineer DJ Wimalasurendra did. You could be one of them.
Thank you, Engineer Sarath Kumar Tilakaratna. It was a very inspiring speech, something that we all find extremely important to bring down our cost of energy. We need hydropower. It was indeed a glowing tribute to the father of hydropower in the country, late Engineer DJ Wimalasurendra. Now may I call upon our President, Engineer Wimalasena Gamage, to hand over a token of appreciation, a memento, to Engineer Sarath Kumar Tilakaratna. Now I would like to call upon the chairman of the Electrical Engineering Sectional Committee of the Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka, Engineer Kosala Kamradaniya, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening. Engineer Wimalasurendra Gamage, President, Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka. Engineer Jayavilal Meegoda, President-elect, Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka. Engineer Dr. Jagat Piris, Executive Secretary ISL. Guest Speaker, Engineer Sarath Tilakaratna, Deputy General Manager, Mahaweli Complex, Ceylon Electricity Board. Past Presidents, Vice Presidents, Council Members and Members of ISL. Family Members of late Engineer DJ Wimalasurendra. Members of Electrical and Electronic Engineering Sectional Committee and ladies and gentlemen. First and foremost, on behalf of the Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka, let me thank Engineer Tilakaratna for readily accepting our invitation and for being with us here today in spite of your busy schedules as our guest speaker to deliver this prestigious Engineer Dr. Wimalasurendra Memorial Lecture, which is one of the most important events in our calendar. Engineer Sarath Tilakaratna, we believe you are a very appropriate person and also you deserve to deliver this lecture, memorial lecture, of the father of hydropower generation in Sri Lanka as the person who is heading one of the hydropower complex and who is having 34 years experience in hydropower generation. Moreover, we are indeed thankful to you for selection of one of the most appropriate topics and giving insight into future role of hydropower in Sri Lanka and also O&M challenges. We also really appreciate and we are so grateful to you, to the family members of late Engineer DJ Wimalasurendra, for being with us on this memorial day. Also on behalf of Electrical and Electronics Engineering Sectional Committee, I would like to thank President Engineer Wimalasurendra Gamage, Executive Secretary Dr. Jagat Piris, and Secretary for making this event a success. My special thanks go to my colleagues in the Electrical and Electronics Engineering Sectional Committee for organizing this event. Also, finally, ladies and gentlemen, let me thank President-elect, Past President, Vice Presidents, Council Members, invitees and every one of you for taking your time to be with us to participate in this year's DJ Wimalasurendra Memorial Lecture. Before saying good night, I need your 2 minutes to deliver a small message. As you know, Institute of Engineers, as the apex body of engineering, always has been taking efforts to enhance and uplift the standards in Sri Lanka. In line with this, actually, Electrical and Electronic Sectional Committee few years ago appointed few committees, subcommittees, to look into national issues where we can help actually. One committee looked into safety aspects of electrical appliances in Sri Lanka. So they studied, I don't know whether you know actually, in 2013 there are 73 electric machines in Sri Lanka, in 2014 there are 76 electric machines in Sri Lanka, 2015 there are 96 deaths due to electric machines. So the team decided that we have to look into the reasons for that one, and they found that one of the contributory factors are substandard devices, especially the multi-socket outlets and power strings used in Sri Lanka. The reason for that multi-socket outlet and power strings are reason because we have a variety of socket outlets in Sri Lanka. We don't have a single standard or standard socket outlet. We have so many socket outlets, and when you buy something from your shop, you don't know which is going to fit, which socket outlet is going to fit into that one. So you buy some cheap multi-socket outlet from the market and finally end up with so many disasters. So the team studied, they proposed single socket outlet standard for Sri Lanka. At the same time, very senior professionals in Sri Lanka, like Dr. Siyambala Pitiya, Professor Lucas, and Jayasiri Karunanayaka, they were also working on the same topic. and we got together as a team, and with the help of PUCSL, which has the authority to implement this execution, actually we managed to get the blessings of the blessings of the cabinet on 16th of August this year. So now actually we have single socket outlet in the single stand for the socket outlet in the country from 16th of August, and in another till another 1 year, that is 2017 August 16th, we can still go ahead with imports, but after that no one can imports other than socket outlet type G in different maybe if we call 13 ampere socket outlet or SCA type socket outlet. But till 2018 August, actually whatever in the market they can sell it, but after that actually there won't be any import, or nothing will be available in the market other than 13 ampere socket outlet. So finally actually we achieved that one. Actually I would like to thank all the members work for that team, and without stopping at that actually our sectional committee, actually we are going beyond another step. Actually now we have identified there are certain reasons, actually another reason contributing for this electric question, that is substandard house wiring and wiring of houses mainly and other installation. So another team is working on this one. Actually now the team has already finalized the document for licensing electricians in the country. So now actually we are looking at the legal framework, how we are going to implement this one. Probably within the next 2-3 months we will go for a public hearing, and you will be able to hear we have a licensing system for electrician in near future. We expect your support, all the support, and I think you will understand the gravity of this one. Please educate whoever, friends or close groups, about the requirement of this one and support us. Thank you very much for you. Good night.